love ice cream. We all should thank the person who invented the ice cream.
Ice cream was not an invention, it was a discovery. Children, we have already seen the difference between invention and discovery. When someone has an idea for something new and makes it work, it's called an invention. And when someone searches or finds out something new and makes it work, it's called a discovery.
So, if this someone had not found how to make ice cream, we would not have been enjoying this tasty, tasty ice cream.
So, how was ice cream discovered?
Children, the first type of ice cream was made around 4,000 years ago, and the first person to taste this ice cream was none other than the Emperor of China.
Wow, he must have been so lucky.
How did they make the first ice cream?
The Emperor's cook prepared a dessert from fruit and juice. Then they packed the dessert in snow till it became chilled, and then they served it to the Emperor. So you see, children, the Chinese were the first to learn how to freeze juices. This then they sold as fruit-flavored ices from carts on street.
Were it just like candies?
You can say that. Then about 2000 years later, the Romans too had similar idea like the Chinese. The emperor ordered fruits to be packed in boxes with ice. The fruits froze in ice and the result was what we all know today as sorbet. When the emperor ate the frozen fruits, he really loved it.
Then how did the ice cream spread all over the world?
In the 13th century, Marco Polo visited China and he also enjoyed the fruit-flavored ices made by the Chinese. He liked it so much that when he returned to Italy, he took with him the recipes of fruit ices to Italy. Then in the year 1550, a Spanish doctor living in Rome discovered the secret of freezing milk and cream. Let us see what he discovered. When you add salt to the ice that is used to freeze, the salt lowers the temperature of ice even further. That means the ice becomes even cooler. This then increased the speed of freezing the milk and creams. When he tasted the frozen milk and the cream, it was delicious. He liked it so much that soon the doctors started selling real ice creams and the people really enjoyed eating those ice creams. Then in the year 1670, an Italian opened a cafe in Paris and sold sorbets and flavored ices. Soon they also became popular. In this way, the whole world started enjoying the delicious ice creams.
But how was ice cream made?
Let me explain it to you. We first mix cream, sugar, and the flavor we want into a small container. This small container containing the mixture is then put in the center of a large container. This large container is filled with ice and salt so that the small container is surrounded by the ice. Then the contents of the small container are stirred until the mixture freezes. And there you are! The ice cream is ready to eat! You too can make ice cream in your house using the freezer of your fridge.
I will try it tonight so that tomorrow morning I can have my tasty, tasty ice cream.
But children, you should not eat too much of ice cream or chocolates because it will spoil your teeth.
And remember, you all should brush your teeth daily and after every meal. Do you know, kids, long, long ago, toothbrushes were not used. Instead, people rinsed their mouths out with water or used their fingers to clean their teeth.
Then when did people start using toothbrush?
It was much later that they found something That was the first toothbrush. People started chewing on the ends of sticks until they became bristly, just like our toothbrush. Then, using these bristles, they started cleaning their teeth. They also sharpened the sticks at the end and used it to clean in between their teeth. This came to be known as toothpick. In China, people at high post were the first to use brushes as teeth cleaners. So you see, initially, using the toothbrushes was limited to the rich and powerful people. As time went by, people in Europe began to use them too. Soon the toothbrush spread all around the world and everyone started using them to clean their teeth.
And when did people start using toothpaste?
Good question, Pete. Children, every morning and after our every meal, we all clean our teeth with our favorite toothpaste and toothbrush. But have you wondered, long before toothpaste was invented, how did people clean their teeth? Let me tell you. Long, long time ago, only the kings and the rich people used a powder that they mixed with water to form a paste. And with this paste, they used to clean their teeth. So you see, children, brushing teeth with powder was only for the rich people. It was considered a luxury. And the powder was made by mixing powdered deer antlers and powdered cattle hooves. Different herbs and honey were also mixed in the powder. Then, in the 18th century, a French dentist developed the first toothpaste. This toothpaste was something like the toothpaste we use today to brush our teeth. He mixed soap and lime to form a paste. Coral and shells were also made into powder. An extract from the bark of the soapwort tree was mixed with water. He dipped a sponge in warm water and used a mixture of above things to clean his teeth. And soon, everybody had toothpaste to brush their teeth.
We clean our teeth with toothpaste, but what do we use to clean our body?
Yes, I know. We use soap to clean our body.
Correct. Children, we human beings have been living on this planet Earth since very, very long. And even before man-made soaps, they used to clean their clothes. So how did they clean their clothes? They used a mixture of wood ashes and water. This loosened the dirt on the clothes. People also washed with plant juices that made a lot of lather. They boiled the bark or berries of the soapwort tree and used the liquid like today our mama does. Like today our mama uses detergent to wash our clothes. They wash their clothes by hand in rivers, by stamping and stomping on them with their feet, by rubbing them against stones or by beating them with a stick. Then many years later, someone decided to bind the powdery ashes with animal fat to make a solid cake. And that was the first bar soap.
Children, because the first soaps were made with animal fat, they smelled bad. Then people started using olive oil instead of the animal fat to make soap. The soaps made with olive oil gave a pleasant smell and people in large numbers started using the soap to clean their body.
But who were the first people to make soaps?
The first soap that we know about today was made by the ancient Phoenicians on the Mediterranean coast. Today, we know that country as Lebanon. They boiled a mixture of goat fat and wood ashes in water until a scum formed on the surface. When the scum became thick, they scooped it up and let it dry into a soap.
But soap was first used to wash clothes and not for personal cleanliness. And very few people use these soaps because of its bad smell. Regular production of soap began only in the 8th century when the bad smell of the soap was overcome. Washing with bars of soap became common only in the 19th century. children, in today's world, we live by the time that is shown by the clock. Our years, months and days are divided into time, and we get to know the time by looking at the clock. But have you ever wondered how people used to record time before the clock was invented?
Actually, children, the first people on Earth did not require to know the exact time of the day. But there sure was a way to know the time. Let us see how. Children, the first people living on the Earth divided their days by rising and setting of the sun and counted the years by the seasons. When the sun was directly over our head, it was considered to be noon. When the sun was close to the horizon in the east, it was early morning, that is the sunrise. And when the sun came to the horizon in the west, it was considered early evening, which is the sunset.
It was only much later that the people began to show the passing of time through clever inventions. And this was around 3,500 years ago. Now, let us see what those clever inventions were and how they were improved to form a modern clock that we use today. Children, long, long time ago, people started telling time by the position of the sun in the sky.
Children, look at this structure. This is called the obelisk. They were made of stone. In ancient Egypt, these monuments were used to tell time. Let us see how. Children, it is interesting to know that as the sun moves in the sky, our shadows also move and become longer and shorter depending on the position of the sun in the sky. These monuments followed the same pattern and served as sundials and kept track of time by their moving shadows as the sun moved in the sky. So by looking at the shadow of the monument, people could tell the time. Children, even today, by looking at your shadows, you can tell whether it's morning, afternoon, or going to be evening. But you cannot tell the accurate time of the day using these methods.
Another interesting thing that earlier people used to tell time was a candle. What they did was, they marked a candle with the hours of the day. Look, this is how the candles were marked for the hours. Now, each of the colored segments represented an hour. These segments were marked with numbers telling the hours of the day. The candles were burned, and if someone had to tell the time, they looked at the candle and saw the number where the candle had reached as it burnt. The number showed what time of the day it was. So children, we can say that these candle clocks were the clocks that burnt time away.
Later on, similar model was made using oil. Look, this was how the model looked. Can you see the markings on the instrument? This instrument was filled with oil and then burnt. As the hours passed, the level of oil came down. When people had to see the time, they simply saw the level of the oil and read the marking of the instrument to know the exact time of the day.
Then came the first mechanical clocks. They were very big and heavy and were driven by hanging weights. These clocks hung mainly in churches and public buildings so that everybody could see the time. And children, these clocks were so heavy and occupied so much space that they could not be kept in houses.
Clocks became popular in houses in the 17th century when the development in these inventions made it possible for mankind to make smaller models of clocks. It was Louis Cartier who created the first wristwatch in the year 1907.
Today in our wristwatches and clocks, we have vibrating quartz crystals that helps us tell the accurate time of the day.
Children, as the clock tells us the time of the day, similarly, can you tell me what do we use to tell the date, day and month of a year?
Calendar!
trade.
It also shows us on which days do we have holiday.
Right. Children, before the calendar was developed, people counted the years by passing of the seasons. This again was not very accurate. Children, before we go into the details of the calendar, let us see what makes a year. When our Earth completes one full circle around the Sun, then we say that we have completed 1 year. This 1 year has all the seasons in it on which the previous calendars were based.
The first calendars were made by the Babylonians. They based their calendars on the phases of the moon. So, the calendars were called lunar calendars. The lunar calendars have 354 days in a year. The Egyptians also followed the lunar calendar, but they discovered something new that gave birth to a new calendar. Let us see what they discovered.
Children, when the Egyptians observed the position of the sun as the earth moved around it, what they noticed was the year was longer than the moon cycle. Yes, so the Egyptians based their calendars on the sun and it was called the solar calendar.
The Roman general Julius Caesar copied the Egyptians but added days to make the year 365 days long. This calendar was known as Julian calendar, but this calendar was also not up to the mark and had months of uneven length and was a bit short. Then, in year 1582, came the Gregorian calendar. It corrected the problems faced by the Julian calendar. It established the average number of days in a month and also added a leap year every 4 years.
What is a leap year?
A year in which we have one extra day. We call it a leap year. And can anyone tell me in which month of the year is this day added to? Yes. Come on. You are all very intelligent and you know the answer, I'm sure.
February?
Very good, Molly. You're absolutely right. Children, if you look at the month of February in a calendar, you'll find that it has 28 days in it. But in some years, it has 29 days in it also. Children, let me tell you something very interesting. There is a way by which you can all find out which years were leap years and which coming years will be leap years.
Wow, how can we do that?
It's all very simple. All you have to do is divide the year by the number 400. If the remainder is zero, then the year is a leap year, or else it's not a leap year.
Wow, it is so easy.
Children, all across the world, people largely use the Gregorian calendar. But there are many places and many people who even today follow the lunar calendar.
Children, today we all have umbrellas in our house. These umbrellas are of different colors and sizes. We take out the umbrella in the rainy season and whenever there is rain, we use it to protect ourselves from the rain. It's also used to protect against the scorching rays of the sun. So you see, rainy season or sunny weather, the umbrella is a must. But do you know, children, that in ancient China about 3000 years ago, people didn't use umbrellas to protect themselves from the rain. The umbrella indicated the rank of a person. So only high-ranking people of China were allowed to carry umbrellas. The important people in China showed their importance and status by having the servants carry umbrellas whenever they went out.
Similarly, in ancient Greek, the umbrella was not used as a protection from rain. The ladies used it to protect themselves from the sun, which was very strong during the summer.
Then how did they save themselves from the rains?
They wore tightly woven capes or cloaks and hats that were made by weaving waxy leaves and grass together. These waxy leaves acted as waterproof.
Was it just like the raincoats we use today?
Oh yes, dear. You can say that. In 18th century Europe, when women started using umbrellas to protect themselves from the sun, men thought that it was really silly thing to use. And then, one rainy season, a man named Jonas Hanway from England started using umbrella to protect himself from the rain. He made it a habit to carry the umbrella with him, whether it rained or not. People started making fun of him and laughed at him.
Why did they laugh at him?
At first, it was not considered good manners for a man to use an umbrella to stay dry in the rainy season. The soldiers were forbidden to use them at all.
But soon, everybody realized that it was senseless getting wet in the rain and more sensible to keep yourself dry in the rain. So, the British gentlemen also started carrying umbrellas and started calling these umbrellas as Hanways on the name of Jonas Hanway.
Still, very few people were using umbrellas. The mass production of umbrellas started after the year 1840 and after Henry Holland had devised steel ribs for umbrellas.
And then came the folding umbrellas in the year 1930. And this folding umbrella was invented in Germany.
Money plays a very important part in our lives. Today, whenever we want to buy something from the market, we have to give some money in exchange for the thing that we want to buy. The money the people of a particular country use is called the currency of that country. And every country on this earth has its own currency.
But it is not that we human beings always use money to buy things. In the prehistoric times, humans themselves produced what they needed. It was like, if I needed something, I will produce it myself. I will not go and buy it from somewhere else. But soon human beings began to grow crops and started living in villages. This led to the development of their social life as they started interacting with lots of people. It was then that they found that they needed to exchange different goods with one another to live. If I produced rice and needed apple, then I will go to a person who produces apple and give that person rice in exchange of apples. This was then developed as a system, and we call this system of giving goods in exchange of goods as bartering. But soon they found that this system was not perfect.
Let us see why it is not perfect. Suppose I produce rice and I want apples. I go to a person who produces apple and ask for it in exchange of my rice. And this is called the barter system. But that person may not need rice. So what do I do now? I will again have to search for another person who not only produces apples, but also needs rice. And how should we decide how much rice should I give and how many apples I should get in return? This makes my life hard.
Soon human beings found a way out and a form of money was agreed upon. And this money replaced bartering. Thus, the fair exchange of various things became easier. Let us now look at some of the first money used by human beings. The country that we know as Iraq was long, long time ago inhabited by the ancient Sumerians. They used clay tokens as money. Look, this is how the clay tokens looked. The shape of the token told the type of item that can be bought by it, and the size told the quantity of the item.
Similarly, the Chinese first paid with cowrie shells. Then by 600 BC, they started casting metal tools and using them as money. Some of the metal tools they made were the bronze hoe and a knife. Look, this is how they appeared.
Soon we human beings realized that coins had to be strong as well as light in weight. This would be easy to carry. From all the materials available to them, they found the metal to be the best. Gold and silver coins became the most valuable coins available. Initially, the coins made had simple designs on them. Then people started minting the coins, and soon the designs on the coin started becoming complex.
The coins came in different shapes and sizes. Some coins even had holes so that they could be carried on a string, like this ancient coin from Japan. So kids, I think by now we all know about so many things that were invented and discovered that changed our lives and our lifestyles. Now, do you want to know about anything else?
Yes, yes, I want to know who discovered the sandwich.
Gobby, do you really want to know about the discovery of sandwich, or do you want to eat sandwich?
Definitely he wants to eat sandwich. When he wanted to eat ice cream, he asked for it.
I think after listening to all those interesting things, we all deserve a sandwich. So let's all go and have a sandwich, and then we will see who came up with the brilliant idea of a sandwich. Children, there's a very interesting story about how the sandwich was introduced to the world. In the year 1762, there lived an English lord. He was a big gambler and was so fond of playing cards that he didn't even leave the table for having his food. But we all feel hungry. He also felt hungry and had to have something to eat. Or else, he will feel very weak and not be able to play. But he didn't want to stop playing the game of card even for a few minutes. This was a great problem for him. And then, he got an idea that solved his problem. He ordered his servant to put slices of meat and cheese between two pieces of bread so that he could use his one hand to eat the bread and with the other hand he could play his favorite game of cards. So you see, children, people come up with various interesting ideas to make their lives simple. This was one of them. At that time, he did not know that this way of eating will become a craze all over the world.
And children, it is also very interesting to know how this type of fast food came to be known as sandwich. Although many people before this English lord must have eaten this combination of meat and bread without giving it a name, but people like the story associated with this English lord. This Englishman's name was John Montagu, and he was the fourth Earl of Sandwich. And so, children, people started calling this combination as sandwich.
Children, what we put in between the two slices of bread are called the filling. And this filling varies across the world. So, children, let us all enjoy our sandwich and remember the English Lord John Montagu, because of whom the world got to enjoy the sandwiches.
And it really tastes good.
Molly, why are you so sad?
I will never be famous because they all have invented and discovered all the things. Now there is nothing for me to do.
Oh, sweetheart, you don't have to be sad. Let me tell you something. As long as we human beings are living on this earth, every day people will be discovering new and new things. They will be inventing exciting things that will make our lives more easy and comfortable. Even now as we talk, there are many people around the world working on discovering and inventing new things or developing upon the things that have already been discovered or invented to make it more perfect. All you have to do is look around you and see what you can make that will help improve the living standard of all the humankind living on the planet Earth.
That means I can still be famous?
Of course, dear. And we are all here to help you succeed in whatever you do. Aren't we, children?
Yes!
Thank you, Vayu. Thank you, Maya.
But Molly, remember, studies are also very important. First, you should complete your homework and finish studying. Then you should think about other things, because when you apply your studies to your thinking, your studies will help you think creatively. And when you start thinking creatively, you will be able to fulfill your dream of being famous by inventing or discovering something new and exciting.
Yes, you are right. Now I will first complete my homework.
That's a good girl.
Vayu, I think now we should take leave of these children and let them finish their homework.
You are right. So children, study hard and remember, I and Maya are always there to help you. So whenever you need our help, all you have to do is call us.
Thank you, Vayu. Thank you, Maya. Bye-bye, Vayu. Bye-bye, Maya.
Bye-bye, kids. Take care and see you very soon.